Hey, Cruncher at PAX Oz 2019. I'm here with Matt Trobbiani. You might know him as the developer of Hacknet and Hacknet Labyrinths, two games I'm yet to play. But you're here with WrestleDunk Sports. Tell me about WrestleDunk Sports, Matt.
Cool. So it's real different. It was pretty weird, like going from something so serious to something so goofy. But I'm making sports games. Love my sports. Anyone that knows me, I'm all about sports, various sporting activities, watching sports, playing all sorts of sports.
Real human sports. Yeah. Oh wait, real human basketball, that's something else.
Regular human basketball. The original name for this game was Normal Human Sports. Yeah. And because I stole that name from Power Hoop, which are right over there, yeah. Because they made regular human basketball, I thought they canned it, so I stole the name from them. And then they stole the name back, and I'm like, I have been robbed. I was so mad. They didn't even know they came to this booth, being like, hey, cool game, what's going on? I'm like, I cannot even believe you would speak to me. And they had no idea, but yeah.
You're all about sports, but when people hear of sports games, they might be like, oh yeah, I love NBA, I love FIFA. But those aren't the real sports. What are the real sports that you have in this game that people are really, really keen to play?
I got wrestling, I got fencing, I got volleyball, and I got Smash Ball, just the normal sport name for adults.
Smash Ball.
Yeah, I got a bunch of sports. They're all like really small games. So the deal with this, right? Yeah. You're sitting down to watch something on Netflix, and there's a show that someone's like, hey, this show's really good. And you know in your heart you want to watch something that's good. But you're like, hey, I don't want to get involved in that. It's too much work, right? But it's not work. You're just sitting there watching something. It's no work at all.
Yep.
And then you watch Suits again, like an idiot, right? And I'm like,
it happens to all of us.
It happens to all of us. And I'm like, why? Why is this happening? Like, I want to watch shows that are good, and yet I watch Suits again. And I'm like, why? Like, I don't know why. So I was like, I'm gonna work this out. So I reckon the same thing happens with games, right? Like, where they're like really good AAA games, but I want to go into like some dumb Flash Sports site and play Slime Sports Volleyball. I play like just two ovals that like bounce, and I'll play it for like 4 hours, and I'll be like, why am I doing this? Like I love it, but I'm also, it doesn't make sense. Anyway, so it's playing like Flash games, Game Jam games are like really small. I think what's good about them is that they're very like pure. They're very like whole, as in they're like, there's nothing in there that doesn't need to be there, because in like 48 hours, you don't have time to make junk that doesn't need to be there, right? And I think the games that result from that are really like clean, very tight. They're like everything in them is necessary, and there's no cruft. I reckon people go from those sort of games, and when they think about what they need to do to scale up to like a commercial release, they add in a lot of things to try and grow it.
They just fluff it.
Yeah, so it feels justified in being like, oh, it's like a product, right? And I think that a lot of the time that ruins it, or it misses like something that's really like essentially entertaining about something that's like so minimalist and tight, it's really good. And I was like, I want to make a bunch of cool games like that. Like, I love games like that, and a bunch of things that I make in a game jam, I like it. And I leave those game jams being like, this game rules, but it'll never be able to be released because it's too small, and if I make it bigger, it'll be ruined.
Yeah.
So I made four of them, and I just like put them all together, and it's like a pack. And it's got like a loose sports theme, but like, that's the game.
Is it going to be online, or are you wanting to really sort of have it be that single, local experience?
It's online as fuck. It's all right, like right from day one, we were like planning out the netcode. Right. The netcode's all custom written.
Right.
The tech behind the networking that's gone into it has been like a big part of this project. So like the networking work is really substantial because we wanted to have that local experience. So you can play like half the players are local, half are online, that sort of thing.
But have it be good.
Right, but have it be like really good. So like if I'm gonna make a whole bunch of little games, right? I think I need to build them on top of the foundation that has like all of the trappings that you want in a really good quality, like indie release, right? And then I can like if the game does well, just patch in new sports, right? Making the sports is the fun bit, but like having the foundation of like really good netcode, it supports like every controller ever. Like it's got a good lobby system where you can like switch between everything like really seamlessly. And I think like building that foundation let me get away with like doing games that were really like minimal, as long as there were a bunch of them.
Hacknet was in the indie showcase years and years ago. You are now back in the indie showcase. How does that feel?
I'd say like, it's like a jokey interview, but this is actually like, this is like a really big thing for me.
Okay, good.
So yeah, like when I'm making games, I go like up and down on them a lot.
Yeah.
And like half the time I'm like, I'm a big brain genius and I've made the best video game of all time.
No one can stop me.
Yeah, and then like, and then a week later, it's like, oh, actually, it was very easy to stop me, and now I feel terrible. And yeah, so I'll go on these like big loops of ups and downs, being like, oh, this game's great, this game's terrible, and like, I think like the closer you get to launch, or like the more pressure under, the more that cycle like compresses. And like when I was releasing Labyrinth, I was like, it was a matter of hours between thinking I was the smartest and dumbest person in the world. And it gets wild. But like, yeah, I've been working on other projects as well as this at the same time. And like, I was under a lot of stress, like during like the, I don't know, like 6 months ago-ish, right? And like, I submitted the game to the showcase when I was on like my big high, and I'm like, this game rules. And then, and I was like, I was in the depths of the lowest low when I like, back when I started like working on other projects, so I was like, this game's gonna die, like what am I doing? And like, it's like, it was stressful trying to follow up Hackdown and everything, so.
Having that sort of reassurance, I imagine, yeah, with so, like that you're doing a good job, I feel like that makes something of a difference.
Right, so like right when I was at the like the lowest of the low for this game, and I was starting to move on to other projects, and I was feeling like it was just gonna die, I like got the call about being in the showcase again. And like a lot of this has just been about like, I really want to like, I've been like trying to learn a lot as a developer when I was making this. And like, I really wanted to just, I guess like it didn't need to be commercially successful, but I needed it to be like, to feel like, you know, I can do good things again. And like to get in the showcase again after it was such a big deal for Hackman, I was so proud of that. It was so, it's such a moment. I was like, it was like such a whiplash, and being like, yeah, maybe it's all gonna be okay. And I'm like trying not to cry. Like I think it was like really important for me. And it's like such an honor to be back. Like I love the showcase. It's such an awesome initiative that PAX does. And like, it's so good to be in a second one. Yeah, so it was really good. That was actually like a really, really important thing for me.
So if people want to know more, where is Russell Dunk Sports going to be, and when is it going to be released?
It's going to be on Twitter, and it's going to be always there. So just follow me on Twitter.
Released on Twitter.
Yeah, no, so if you want news about that sort of thing, just follow the game on Twitter. It's at Russell Dunk Game. Or follow me. I'm at Oren, and I'll be tweeting about all that sort of thing. It's going to be out on Switch. That's the only one confirmed, maybe other platforms, you know, I don't know yet. I don't want to confirm anything, yeah, without being super sure. And that'll probably be aiming for release sometime, you know, December, January, but we might be dodging around AAA stuff, so we might just spend the extra time tweaking it up and release sometime good. Sometime good, just cut.
Whenever it works.
Yeah, release whenever we're ready. So it's, we're not sure yet, but you know, roughly end of this year, start of next year, you know, who knows?
Yeah. Well, there it is, Russell Dunk Sports. Matt, thank you so much for chatting with me about your game and the whiplash of game development.
Yeah, you're very welcome. Thanks.